158 Media Conference Call. Today's conference is being recorded. At this time, for opening remarks and introductions, I would like to turn the conference over to Mr. Steve Keough. Please go ahead, sir.
Thanks, Marvin. Welcome to the UFC Media Conference Call, everyone. UFC 158 takes place on Saturday, March 16th from the Bell Center in Montreal, and it's headlined by the welterweight title fight between Georges St-Pierre and Nick Diaz. That night, we'll also see other key matchups in the welterweight division between Carlos Condit and Johny Hendricks, as well as Jake Ellenberger against Nate Marquardt. There are still a limited number of tickets available for the event at the Bell Center, and they're available through the Bell Center box office or online at eventco.ca. UFC 158 is live and available on pay-per-view at 10 p.m. Eastern, 7 p.m. Pacific, with the prelims airing in the U.S. on FX Live at 8 p.m. Eastern. In Canada, fans can catch the prelims on TVA Sports starting at 7 p.m., and on Sportsnet at 8 p.m. Today, we're joined on the call by five of the six welterweights headlining the UFC 158, as well as President Dana White and Director of Canadian Operations Tom Wright. I want to thank Georges St-Pierre, Nate Marquardt, Jake Ellenberger, Carlos Condit, Johny Hendricks for joining us today. Before we start, just a few words from President Dana White. Go ahead, Dana.
Hello, everybody. Thanks for calling in. We appreciate it very much for your time. And I don't think there's any shocker. We're looking for Nick Diaz. We can't find him. As soon as we do, we'll get him on the call.
Hello?
Who's got the first question?
You kidding me?
Nick, are you on?
Yeah, hello?
Okay, great. Thanks for joining us, Nick. So everybody, all fighters are on the call. Please go ahead with your first question.
I will go first to, if you'd like to ask a question, please signal by pressing star 1 on your telephone keypad. If you're using a speakerphone, please make sure your mute function is turned off to allow your signal to reach our equipment. Again, press star 1 to ask a question. I will go with Neil Davidson with the Canadian Press. Please go ahead.
Carlos Condit. Carlos, you're in a somewhat unique position to comment on the main event, given your experience with the fighters. I wonder what your take is on the GSP Diaz fight. How do you think that's going to go?
I think it's an interesting matchup. You know, their styles are, you know, really different. I think Nick can pose some problems to George, but ultimately I see George coming out on top.
Okay, and if I could have a quick follow-up with Dana. Dana, a lot of people, I think yourself included and George, has said that that the St-Pierre-Diaz fight was the one that fans wanted to see. Obviously, Johny Hendricks had been on a good run. But why do you think, what is the appeal of GSP and Diaz? Is it the conflict of styles or conflict of personalities or both?
I think it's both. And like Carlos Condit said, I think that Nick Diaz, his stand-up, you can't emulate his stand-up. I don't care who you bring in. The kid's boxing is unbelievable. He's got great hands. And he knocks people out. Georges St-Pierre's wrestling is phenomenal, and Diaz is great on the ground, too. And this is the fight that the champ wanted. The champ wanted this fight. Diaz has been asking for this fight for a long time, so it's the fight that's happening first.
Okay, thanks very much.
Thank you. We'll go next to Ben Folks with USA Today. Please go ahead.
Yeah, my question first for George. We've seen this ad kind of running on a loop with Dana saying that you called Nick Diaz the most disrespectful person you've ever met. I'm curious what prompted that description from you, and I'd also like to hear a reaction from Nick.
Well, it's not the first time that the guy that I'm fighting tried to get in my head. I've fought many people before that disrespect me. And for me, it's another fight, and train very hard, ready for the fight, and I don't focus on that. I focus on things that I do control. I don't focus on things that people are saying about me. I focus only on myself and what I'm going to do.
Great. And Nick, I mean, if you care to respond to, I'm sure you've seen that ad by now, with Dana saying that George has called you the most disrespectful person you've ever met. What do you think about that?
I don't know. I'd say he's out of line a little bit. I just demanded the amount of attention I felt I should have been getting.
Hey, yeah, you have a question?
Yeah. Okay. And you know, I just think that, you know, we're both martial artists, and I think I would I'd like to be considered, you know, for who I am, and I come from a background of important MMA fighters and martial artists, and it's not just a joke, you know. And people like to talk about my skill level and my wins and this and that, but I had to make do with I had to work with what I got started, and I think he can appreciate that, and he can understand that and respect that, and I think that he knows that I'm the right guy to be in this position right now, and that's why I'm in this position right now, and I think that he knows it, and he respects that, and I don't know, that's pretty much what comes into my head.
Great. And quickly follow up with George. Was there a specific incident that prompted you to say that to Dana, or was it just, you know, watching Nick?
Well, yeah, I suppose that it was just, you know, there's a lot of, you know, I don't get a lot of recognition for what I'm not set out to do here. And, you know, you look at a lot of these guys right now are really important. You guys have, like, red carpet events and awards and magazines. And, you know, I think it should be, I'd be pretty upset. You know, I'm coming here to whoop this guy's ass. And then, you know, before you know it, this fight happens. Nobody knows who I am. I mean, I guess everybody does. But as far as, like, your mainstream magazines and your Nike Adidas and all your good stuff, you know, I'm left out of that. And you know, that's too bad for Hello? Are you there? Yeah.
Yeah.
I said that's too bad.
Hello?
Hello, are you there? Hello.
We can hear you, Nick.
Okay. All right, well, yeah, you know, I just think that, I should be given the credit that I deserve, and that George St. Pierre should be given, this sort of decorated opponent that he deserves, and, you know, I'm hardly that. From the fans' perspective or from the people's perspective, and you know, that makes me pretty angry. And then when I come off on a video, I come off pretty angry. So you know, you can talk about all this disrespect and how I bring forth all this disrespect. I'm so disrespectful, but I'm disrespectful only because I would like the acknowledgement that I've gotten over the last. I've gotten over the last months or weeks leading up to this fight from George St. Pierre, because he will tell you right now that he believes that I'm the right guy to be in this position, and I think that that's for a very important reasoning, you know, and I think that should be brought to the table, and you know, that's a lot of time, that's where a lot of my attitude comes from, but you know, all said and done, you know, he's ready to fight, he's ready to recognize me as the rightful opponent, and so I don't got no problem.
Right,
but I'm ready to fight. I don't know, you know, how the fans feel about that. I'm not over here trying to make friends. I don't know what you want me to say. You know, disrespectful. What? You know, I think it's disrespectful that people try to act like I'm not important. You know who I am. Everybody knows who I am. George knows who I am. And I know that if I were in his position, I would know especially who I am. Especially, number one, first and foremost. So that's all I can say about that, I guess.
All right, great. Thanks.
Thank you. We'll go next to AJ Perez from FoxSports.com.
For George, there's a on Twitter, there's a kind of a trendy thing the last couple days, GSP's Dark Place. Have you seen that? That kind of, that those tweets coming out the last few days, and you know, what do you think about that?
No, I have not seen it. I never tweet once in my life. I have people doing it for me and posting the stuff for me. And I'm not into the social media at all, unfortunately.
And a follow up for Diaz. Do you you know, this whole Dark Place thing? You've seen it mentioned several times. You know, what do you think his dark place is, Nick?
I'm sorry. Tell me again. A dark place.
Yeah, the GSP said he's gonna drop from a dark place to kind of in this fight coming up next week. Do you have a lot to draw off of?
I don't know why he's acting up. I think he should just be himself and do his thing. You know, he wants to come all from the dark side on this one. I don't understand it. Like, I really don't. I could give it. You know, I don't care. I don't care. I'm not told about how they're gonna portray me or him, or they don't give me any like ideas or plans on how they're gonna do some sort of a build up or a prime time, or if they're gonna do it or if they're not gonna do it. I'm sitting around and plan like how I'm gonna act or how I'm gonna come off. Oh, I better say something intimidating, or I better talk this shit or that shit, you know? I just gotta do what I gotta do, you know? So I don't know what he's going through with the whole dark side or where he comes from or whatever. I know where the fuck I come from. I don't have to, like, you know, dredge up some bullshit to get everybody excited. But whatever, you know, you got to do what you got to do. I mean, they put you up to doing what you got to do as well, too. They want to tell you you're exciting, you're not exciting, you're important, you're not important. You wonder, too, if you're not in the media circle, you wonder what the fuck's going on. I'm sure you worry about it. You know, I mean, you got to wonder how you're coming off if you ain't paying attention to what the fuck's on the internet. And then now you're over here doing like I'm from the dark side mode. I don't know. I'm ready to do my job. I got fight. I'll keep it real.
Thank you. We'll go to our next question from Dave Diebert with Post Media News. Please go ahead.
All right. Hi, guys. Thanks for the time. Question for George. It's to do it for us. I'm wondering what you've been working with him for a long time now. I'm wondering what's clicked with the two of you, you know, as a coach and a fighter. That's been so successful together.
Yes, Ferraz used to be one of my training partners before, but he always been a very good, very very good technical guy. Very, very. Ferraz always been more cerebral, so to speak, than everybody else in the gym. He always had that teaching skill. So at one point, I didn't have any trainers that were competent in every areas. So I asked Ferraz if he wanted to take care of me and teaching me, become my number one coach, and he did, and so things going very well.
Now you obviously, you know, spend some time with Greg as well, but you know, for years, you know, it's been you and Farah. Have you, you know, how do your personalities, you know, how have they meshed well, you know, that you guys have been successful together for so long like that?
Well, as far as he's a good friend of mine. He's also a personal friend of mine, not only a trainer. So we have a different relation together. So he knows what goes through my mind and everything, through my life. And maybe that's what makes it easier for, you know, it's easy. There is no barrier.
Okay. All right. You know what? That's good. Thanks very much, George.
Thank you. We'll go next to Mac Engel with Fort Worth Star-Telegram. Please go ahead.
Thank you. This question is for Dana White. Dana, I've asked this question before because I keep hoping I get the answer I want. Are you guys any closer to putting on a big event at Cowboy Stadium in 2013? Or are we looking now at 2014?
It's Steve Keir from the UFC. Dana, unfortunately, had to drop the call. He might be able to rejoin us later, but unfortunately, right now, he's off the call.
Okay.
Sorry.
You know what, if I've got one, then I want to get this into GSP. I know the fight, you've got a big fight coming up, but the fight that everybody's dying to see is you and Anderson. Do you think you might get that done this year, or do you even think about it at this point?
I don't care about it at all. I'm not thinking past Nick Diaz. This is the mistake everybody does, and I respect my opponent as much as people believe. I want the big fight. But the big fight for me right now is Nick Diaz. I don't look past Nick Diaz. All my focus is on him. I don't think about past him. I don't care about what is coming in next. For me, my life ends March 16 when I fight Nick Diaz. It's going to be another chapter in my career after what's going to happen after. But now I'm focusing only on what's going to happen next.
Okay, thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Thank you. We'll go next to Gabrielle Beeland with La Presse. Please go ahead.
Hi. My question would be for Nick. Nick, this is arguably the biggest fight of your career. Have you, has your preparation been any different for this fight?
Sure. I like to think that I've been training a little bit smarter. Of course, I like to think that I do that every fight or every year. But you know, I'm always on that. That's why I'm always on that, looking towards the future. Me and George St. Pierre, we're a lot different. The way we go about our, like, I look past every opponent because I know that I'm in this. I'm not just looking at one obstacle. You know, I think for me, it's easier to deal with when I accept the fact that I'm never going to get out of this. And there's always, it's not just a fight, it's fighters. They got to fight, you know. So, I've looked past every opponent to get to the number one spot of the welterweight division. And then I look past that, I look further beyond that. Like, if it were up to me to say, I would take that fight with Anderson Silva, I would say, yeah, of course. I'm looking forward to the next best thing, always. And, you know, right, you know, the next best thing has always been the next closer fight to the number one fight. And I've been working towards this whole time. And so I always have that mindset. So when it comes to my training, I always go about my training with this same exact mindset, and helps me deal with, day to day and every day.
And Nick, you mentioned that you are looking past Georges St-Pierre. It's your mentality. And what do you see past Georges St-Pierre for yourself?
I don't know. I'll have to take a long, hard look. But if I had that option available to me, I would be honored to be in that position, and I would be gratefully accepting of that position or fight, if you will, with the 85-pound champion or the 155-pound champion. I would take either fight, and I think I could beat either guy. I'd like to be the guy to win a title at both weights. I'd like to be a runner-up in the pound-for-pound rankings, and you know, that's the number one goal. Aside from the number one ranking at in the welterweight division, but I think what I've been first, that's what I've been working for or working towards here.
Thank you, Nicole.
Thank you. We'll go next to Victor Garcia with Fox News Latino. Please go ahead.
All right. GSP, I wanted to ask you a question. Number one, if Nick Diaz didn't call you out after the BJ Penn fight, would you have asked for this matchup?
Yes, because I think it was victory over BJ Penn, and the way he beat BJ Penn solidifying his position as the number one guy. And his fight with Carlos Condit is a very close decision that he lost, and I believe it solidifies his position as the number one guy. And I believe, would like to fight him because of that, of course.
All right. Now, Nick, I wanted to ask you, how much do you really hate doing this type of stuff, like these conference calls and like that? I know a lot of press has been going on about that. You know, how much do you dislike doing this stuff?
I like it just fine. I just like to know about it. Like, I got the heads up here. Like, I checked my messages last night, and I had been getting messages yesterday about this call today. So, luckily, I was running a little bit late. Otherwise, I wouldn't even have known that I had a call. And so, you know, it's just, for me, like, a couple weeks away from the fight, I'm pretty focused in doing the rest of what I got to do. And, you know, when I got cameras following me around, and you know what, I don't mind that either. I don't care if there's a camera crew sitting in the back seat of my car. I can give a shit. I just don't like, what I'm not ready for. I don't know about it. You know, you got George, they got someone over there powdering his nose out. You know what I mean? And they're gonna send him off for a video shoot. You know, he's got someone gonna make a Twitter for him. Now he don't even know how to talk. He don't know how to act right. He's got people living his life for him in the open or in the public. I mean, I would like to just stay out of, like, I would like to just keep it real, you know, that way I don't got to put on no image. I don't know how it works out, you know. I'm not in his shoes, so I don't know. I have, like, a little assumption I can make from time to time. But, you know, I think that I would just like to keep it real, you know, and be me, but it's really hard to do. You walk around everywhere and everybody knows who I am. And it's embarrassing, too, you know. When you're not looking the way you want to look and coming off the way you want to come off, but everybody on every street corner knows who you are. They can see you a mile away. They're like, hey, and they point a finger. You can't get away from that, you know? So it's the same thing as a video camera, and I'm happy for it. I'm ready for it, but, I mean, I'm happy for it when I'm ready for it, you know? And, you know, like, my life's a mess. I'm not afraid to admit it. You know, I work hard regardless through this shit. But I don't have people, you know, telling me off and handing me water bottles left and right and getting my, you know, training ready for me and getting my shit ready. I got to do all that shit on my own. And every day I know it, that I'm over here doing it on my own. And that's why I know I have to go that much harder and concentrate and do that much more, because I don't have people sending tweets out for me. I don't have people taking care of my money or financial tax obligations or whatever, what have you. All that stuff that's important that, you know, people don't want to talk about. Yeah, I'm pretty fucked there, because I'm too busy fighting all your fights. I'm too busy entertaining all the fans. I don't see anybody else bringing shit to the table. You know, this martial arts works for them, too, when it comes to, like, the way that everybody wants to be, like GSP. Everybody wants to be strong, and they want to have the fitness, and they want to just kind of overcome that technical aspect by just being stronger, more explosive, quicker, you know, beating you to the punch when it comes to the scoring in 5 minutes. And it's just, it's really not what martial arts is about. And this is mixed martial arts, and that's what we should bring to the table for the fans. That's what the fans want to see. And that's, they can recognize that, obviously, because I've lost a shitload of fights. But guess what? I'm here. I'm here to fight because people know what they want to see. They want to see real skill level. They want to see real boxing. They want to see real traditional jiu-jitsu, real boxing. They want to see it put together and mixed up, you know, and they want to see mixed martial arts. They don't just want to see 5 minutes of holding. I think that people should be pointing deducted for it, but or running away or holding on, you know. You should have to punch down or make action, you know. But that's just, you know, people should be able to see that a little better, but that's whatever. Maybe one day.
Thanks, Nick. GSP, are you pampered?
I'm sorry?
Are you know, going back to Nick's comments for a response, are you pampered?
I hope so, motherfucker. If I had that much money, I'd be fucking pampering myself the fuck up. I'd be having motherfuckers pampering my shit left and fucking right. There'd be motherfuckers every hour on hour showing up to pamper me out, period.
Damn.
If I had that sort of investment to make, that'd be that.
Let me tell you something. Let me tell you something, uneducated fool. Listen to me.
I'm going off what I said. You do a great job of explaining and making things real for what they are, motherfucker. I'm not stupid. I can tell what's what.
Yeah, you look pretty smart right now.
No, I'll listen. You say what you're going to say. I'll listen. You say what you're going to say, and, you know, I can understand you. The rest of the people in the world should be able to understand you when you try to say whatever it is that you're supposed to say, so say it.
I'm not always been like this. I've not always been rich. I start from the bottom. I made myself. I work very hard to be where I am right now. And as much as I know you don't believe this because you didn't succeed yet, and maybe you will never succeed in your life because I don't think you're smart enough to understand how you should do to reach that point. But what I do, when you talk about stuff that people doing for me, it's called passive income. When you reach a point that you for your business, you need people, you need a team to work for you to make the economy, to make the money rolling.
That sounds nice, George. Okay, if I wore some tight shorts out there and got a fucking haircut and I had someone buttering me up halfway through telling me this bullshit, maybe it would have worked out. But I doubt it. You don't even know where I come from. You're trying to talk about where you come from. You should see this shit over here. Nobody wants to come out here. Nobody gives a shit about who
you don't know anything about me, man. You don't know anything about me. You think
okay.
I'm born
rich.
No,
I'm sure. I am not,
I'm my
sure
friend.
I'm sure you worked hard. I'm sure
you
worked hard.
You have no idea. You have no idea where I come from.
Sure
you have no idea.
Shit. No, you worked on your backflip and you got your shit right and you fucking got out there.
Yeah.
And
I succeed, you're not the only jealous guy who's gonna take my
place. Right. I'm not jealous, okay? You did the right shit what you had to do. Hey, you had a year on me too, but you got that fight and you won that fight, alright? You know, I was coming right behind you. I don't have anything to say to you. I don't mean to be disrespectful. I don't have anything against you. I don't have anything. When it comes to what you're doing, and I think you've done a great job, to be honest with you. I just so that you know that, I think that you do a wonderful job for who you are and what you do and what you have to work with or whatever it is. You know, sure, you're pampered out, okay? I don't have anything against that. All I'm saying is, look, I hope so, motherfucker, because this is some fucked up shit. And if I had the money and if I had the right people on my side working for me, if I have some motherfuckers drop a dime on this guy and that guy to make sure I have my shit ready for me, I would be doing it, and you bet your ass would get done. But I'm over here still doing that shit. Try that shit from when you're 21 all the way to when you're fucking some 32, which you are now. It's a bitch.
Right. If you are where you are right now, and I am where I am, it's not my fault. It's because of you, man. You did not succeed. You did not
okay,
succeed
I didn't,
because
okay.
of you, man. Because
okay.
of you.
Whatever.
You
whoever said it. Whenever I was never putting any blame or pointing any fingers towards you or anything being your fault. You're the one fucking rapping about how you're not pampered or you are pampered. Who? Whatever. Answer the fucking question, then. That's all this is about. You don't have any fucking arguments with me.
Pampered? I don't even know what does that mean, man. That pampered.
You don't even know what does that mean? What the fuck? You don't have any arguments.
I don't understand half of the word that you're saying because your English is. I speak English better than you, man. Because talk to me like a normal human being, man.
No, you're talking shit and you're out of line, bro. Straight up. You understand that, right? You're rapping that bullshit. And you're fucking out of line. Understand that. I didn't say shit. The guy asked what you think about being pampered and shit like that. You didn't even get to answer the question because I said, motherfucker, I hope you're pampered.
You see, what you said, I don't understand half of what you said. I don't understand what you said, Nick. I don't even understand. I don't care. I don't know what you mean.
You don't got to understand it anyway.
It's basically what
that is. The Dana man.
Okay, well, let me understand your English, Marvin.
We will go to the next question from Ron Kruk with Inside MMA. Please go ahead.
Hey, guys. Don't really know how to follow that up. Let's go over to George St. Pierre. George, you know, there's no secret that you wanted Nick Diaz for a while now, and just hearing some of the things that were said in this exchange, I mean, have you ever gone into a fight with so much, you know, animosity between you and your opponent?
Yes.
What? Why would he want to fight me anyways? What did I ever say? He ain't got enough goddamn reason to fight me. Straight up. I mean, other than that, I'm the number one martial artist, not because I'm disrespectful, I got a bad attitude, and I deserve to get beat down. That's what you said, right? Who the fuck are you? I'm over here. You know what? Honestly, straight up, I don't think that you deserve to get beat down. I don't think that. I don't think, you know what? I don't want anybody to get beat down. I'd like to win the fight. Like I said, you're over here. You know me, don't you? You know me real well. You know I deserve to get beat down.
You seriously believe I'm afraid of you, man? Are you seriously
No, motherfucker. Look, I seriously believe that you told that to the camera. So you believe that I deserve to be beat down. So for whatever I've done in my life, for whoever
I deserve it for
running my mouth to get this position to become something of what you are, and now I deserve to get beat down, and you're making those statements on like to the whole world. That I am this piece of shit that deserves to be beat down, and then you let Dana talk like I'm the most disrespectful person that you've ever met, and I deserve to take an ass whooping, or you're gonna beat the shit out of me, and you let him say that. Check it out, motherfucker. I pull up to a stoplight the other day, and some fucking 40-year-old lady, some soccer mom, sticks her head out the window, and she's like, "I hope GSP beats your ass." We're in fucking Lodi, bitch. I'm like, are you serious? We are in Lodi right now. You hold me to beat my ass. That's fucking wonderful. I'm living in a fucking small town full of people that hate me over here. And, you know, I'm trying to fucking work my way up into a fight. And now I'm the most disrespectful piece of a person that walks the earth. And I deserve to have the shit beat out of me. And I'm just this disgusting person because... You know what? When you say something, everybody fucking believes it, dude. Everybody wants to know what George thinks and what George says and what it looks like, how George looks, and wear tight shorts like George and get strong and forget about jiu-jitsu, forget about boxing, let's do a Superman punch like George. Fuck mixed martial arts. fuck the martial arts aspect and the jiu-jitsu, and where the fuck did you come from? Who the fuck gave you your black belt? I think that guy deserves more credit. Whatever. That's
Nick.
I guess that's disrespectful right there. If you want your disrespect, that's it right there. Anything I've ever done in the past, well, you know where I was coming from there. I'm just trying to make my way to the top, trying to make my spot, trying to promote my fight. That's all I get. That's all I got. That's all I get. That's all I do.
Have you listened to yourself, Nick? Listen to yourself a little bit. You would understand.
Right, okay, because I'm crazy. Oh, but you know what? Okay, fine for the fans, right. I'm this crazy motherfucker, but you know what? You know where I'm coming from, bro. You're not stupid. And you understand every fucking word I'm saying right now. You're over here trying to talk shit. Why don't you just drop it? Why don't you just say, look, we're going to go out, we're going to have a fight. I'm not a disrespectful human being. I don't deserve to be beat down. Okay, you think you're going to fucking win for whatever fucking reason. And that's that, you know? Don't get me wrong, you have a good reason to think that. You're the number one, you're the best, right? That's fine, that should be enough right there. You know, I'm disrespectful of this, that. I'm the most fucking piece of shit out there. You know, I'm sure you can find worse than me. That's not the reason why we're fighting. That may be the reasons why the fans, you know, built this fight and why, you know, it's the, or what sparked up, you know. But I'm the right guy. Who the, you know, you want to fight. What,
yeah, yes, you are. You're,
old doors, right.
Listen to me.
Thank you.
You are the right guy, Nick. You are the right guy.
You're going to go out there and work out with Johny? You guys going to have a wrestling match? No. That's not when nobody wants to see that.
We're fighting each other because you're the right guy. You're the number one guy. And the fact that there is a lot of animosity, it's good for the fight. It's good promotion. Everybody wants to have that fight because you're the right guy. I don't wish you a bad life. I don't wish you bad things. It's a fight. I want to win. We all want to be champion. We all want the number one spot. It can only be one guy. It's a lot of animosity. It's a full contact fight. We can die there. We can lose our, you know, it's a dangerous sport we're doing. That's why it's a lot of tension. The best man will win, and that's it. That's what it's going to be. The best man will win.
And we'll go to our next question from Ariel Alwini. Please go ahead.
The question for Nick. Obviously, it's been a while since we've talked to you and you've had a fight, and you're obviously very open and almost, I'd say, excited today. Is this kind of your way of maybe unleashing some of the feelings that you've kept inside for the last year since you've been out of the limelight?
No. I guess I like to think I'm just talking in my defense, you know, because it's hard, you know, you never know how things are going to come off on, you know, on video or what people, it doesn't matter. I have already come off a certain way to the people, to the world. It's kind of like you go down that road, there's no going back. It's kind of rough. But as far as the people who are going to look in and listen in and what's going to be written down on paper, I like to be known as someone who kept it real. And, you know, I just don't like that I'm made out to be this evil person that needs to be, you know, shot, like shot down, or, you know, that needs to be, like, conquered, you know? What the fuck? If anything, I'm like a superhero coming in with the, you know, the anti-bullshit. You know, give me a fucking break. Are you seriously going to stick to the bullshit forever? This is mixed martial arts, ladies and gentlemen. This is some boring-ass shit we're watching lately. You know, and we should see something new as far as I'm concerned. I don't mean to talk shit. I like George. I'm a fan of George St. Pierre. I appreciate everything he does, and he does what he does to win. I just think that, you know, and it meets the scoring criteria. I think that should be changed. I think that sucks. I think that really fucks it up for everybody. But, you know, people hate me for saying that too, but especially the strong wrestler, especially the strong guy. He hates me for that one, and doesn't want to hear it and would love to ignore it. But one day, I think the rest of the people of the world are going to see mixed martial arts for what it is and what it used to be and maybe start to, you know, manipulate this the way it works a little bit. I mean, come on, the scoring and the judging and the system and the whole, it's crap. I think they should just go ahead and take the elbows out too. I just think that it's just, it kind of makes it, nullifies the action. And the whole, it just, that's how it works, man. One day people are going to realize, and then they're going to look back. They're going to look back, and they're going to say, man, this motherfucker right here, he was saying that the whole time.
So. Okay, and I just had a follow-up for Johny. Is he still there?
Yeah, I'm here.
John, you know, Nick just said that no one wants to see you fight GSP, and, you know, I don't think you've been asked a question on this call, and I know you consider yourself the number one contender. Does listening to this bother you?
No, it doesn't, because if he's watching my fights, when have I ever took anybody down? You know what I mean? I have wrestling. Yeah, I do. My background is wrestling. I have knockout power, you know what I mean? Just because I don't go out there and use it all, you know, you don't have to use it all to win fights. You know what I mean? The most important thing is to win fights. Doesn't matter how you do it. If that means you got to take the guy down to get a win like George does, then do it. You know, it's about getting your hand raised, and the fans like that. You know what I'm saying? So it is what it is. You know, he has his opinion. I got mine. You know, it doesn't matter. So the only thing that matters is, like George said, is everybody's got to be on top, but there can only be one, and we're all fighting to get there. Thanks, guys.
Thank you. We'll go to our next question from Dave Meltzer with Wrestling Observer MMA Fighting. Please go ahead.
Yeah, this is for Johny. What do you make of all this, and what's kind of like your thought about just the whole build up to this, between this fight and also you starting out, you know, having one fight and switching to a very different opponent? I mean, what's kind of been like your mentality through the last, you know, 2-3 months since you started training and, you know, coming to this one and your, you know, goals to get that championship?
You got to constantly be adapting, meaning that, you know, of course I wanted to fight George St. Pierre, but he chose somebody else. All right, cool. You know, I had Jake Ellenberger. I trained very hard for him. Then, you know, I was able to get Carlos Condit, an excellent fighter. You know, that's what it's all about. You know what I mean? Take it fight by fight, day by day. You know, that's how I live it. That's how I train. You know, nothing else matters but Carlos Condit at this point. If I even think about overlooking him, he'll definitely beat me. You know, so I got to go out there, and nothing else matters but Carlos Condit.
And for George, as far as, like, you know, the comeback from the knee injury and everything like that, you know, how long did it take you physically and mentally to get to where you felt you needed to be to fight at the level that you're used to fighting?
You mean after my injury, when I had my knee injury, or?
Yeah. I mean, like, how long before you were really comfortable and you know, happy with, you know, your athletic ability was back to where you wanted it to be?
After when I had my surgery, had my ACL surgery, I would say after nine months. After 6 months, I was able to move like I want to. But 9 months was all my reflex, man. I was pretty much where I left behind. Nine months it took.
Okay, thank you guys very much.
Marvin, we'll take one more question.
Thank you. We'll go to our next question from Nancy O'Day from TVA Sports Montreal. Please go ahead.
Oui, deux questions en français pour Georges Saint-Pierre. Georges, tu t'attendais à ce qu'il y ait des gros mots et tout ça, c'est pas la première fois que ça t'arrive. À quel point ça peut te déconcentrer? Je pense que tu étais prêt à ça. Est-ce que ça te déconcentre ou au contraire, c'est quelque chose qui peut te motiver pour le 16 mars?
Non, au contraire, ça me motive, ça va me garder plus concentré sur le spectacle. Et je suis vraiment prêt pour le 16 mars, alors prêt pour la guerre.
À quel point, Georges, on a parlé beaucoup de guerre personnelle entre vous deux, mais les deux, vous dites que c'est pas le cas. Dans quel aspect ce combat-là représente un défi pour toi? Dans quel aspect c'est un combat qui va intéresser les fans? plus que tes combats, notamment contre Krochek ou contre Condit, par exemple?
Il y a beaucoup d'animosité entre les deux et je crois que le fait qu'il y a une histoire en arrière, ça porte attention et je crois aussi que le style qu'on a, on match très bien ensemble, point de vue style, et ça va être un combat explosif.
Ok, merci.
Thanks, Nancy, and thanks, everyone. I want to thank all the fighters for joining the call today, also the media, Dana White and Tom Wright. I just want to update a quick update on the schedule for UFC 158. Open workout is going to take place Wednesday, March 13th from 11 a.m. to 2 p.m. It's downtown Montreal at Complexe des Jardins. We're going to have a full day of events free for fans from 8 a.m. to 6 p.m. UFC Fight Week pre-fight press conference will take place at the Bell Center. This is not open to the public. It'll be on Thursday, March 14th at 1 p.m. at Miso Jure Restaurant, same place as post-fight. Fight Club Q&A on Friday at Bell Center is going to be with Matt Hughes. That's at 2 p.m. Weigh-ins will be at the Bell Center at 4 p.m. Eastern that day. And the first fight slated for 6:35 on Saturday night. Also, a quick reminder that tickets for the Ultimate Fighter finale, which takes place on April 13th in Las Vegas, go on sale March 8th. That's through Ticketmaster in the Mandalay Bay Events Center box office. Ryan Faber will meet Scott Jorgensen in the main events, while the Ultimate Fighter finale will also go down. I want to thank everyone again for the call, and we'll see you all next week in Montreal. Merci. Thanks, Marvin.
You're welcome. This will conclude today's conference. Thank you for your participation.